Thank you, Payal. Good evening, everyone. And of course, in addition to Payal and me, always, there are the other four women that I'd like to name. Nina, Shuli, Ritu, and Anjali, who join both of us in welcoming you here today for, as Payal said, the last evening of 2017. This whole year has been very exciting for us, and I hope it's been as exciting for all of you. Some of you have been sending us wonderful feedback on email. It's certainly made us feel very worthwhile. And all of you, there's been a kind of common thread to what all of you have said is precious about Algebra for you. And that is that you've said it's really opened up and been an intellectual stimulant and a place of pleasure at the same time. And we feel really gratified that that's the kind of feeling that Algebra has managed to create for you. We've had a really splendid lineup of speakers. I'm sure many of you will remember them just very eclectically from the world of cinema. There's been Karan Johar, Farhan Akhtar, Javed Akhtar, Gulzar Saab, Nasir, Sharmila Tagore, Vidya Balan, Anurag Kashyap, you know, Sanjay Dutt, a whole lineup of them. Politically, of course, we've had Omar Abdullah, Mr. Chidambaram, we've had Subramaniam Swamy, Rajiv Chandrasekhar, Akhilesh Yadav, and a whole lot more. Economically, we've had Montek Singh Aluwalia, Surjeet, Ratin Roy, and you know, we can go on. We've had Abhinav Bindra and Kailash Kher, Shubha Mudgal. All of them have really been fascinating, but if I were to just pull one or two threads out of that, there's been two things. One, that almost every accomplished person that we have brought here has spoken of facing great rejection and great failure before they pivoted into being the public personas that they are. And they have all shared that journey, the psychological journey of turnaround. And that's been a really precious handout and giveaway that they've given us. And the second is, I'm sure, not a lesson that many parents would want to know, children to learn, but almost every accomplished person who's come here has said that school was a waste of time, college was a waste of time, and many of them are school dropouts. So I think a lot of us have gone back, hunted out our MA degrees and torn them, because it's proof that we are never going to get anywhere in life, you know? So I hope next year we continue that very reaffirming message about the lack of education leading to the path of success. And right up today, we have a small change in program. We had communicated to you two excellent sessions, one on the judiciary, one from cinema. But we woke up this morning to a wonderful message from one of your members, Unmesh and Parij Haveri. And they gifted us, literally, the first session of this evening, which is about a woman who was leading a very ordinary life. She'd done a course in law. She was a management consultant, going about her life in a commuter train in London, and really wondering whether this is all that life amounted to. So what she did was she wrote two obituaries. She wrote one obituary which would sum up her life as she was living it, and she wrote another obituary about how she would have liked to be known before she died. And when she saw the stark contrast between the two obituaries, she decided she had to do something. And that's how Roz Savage, the woman that we're going to meet, was born, who moved from being a management consultant to becoming the only woman in the world, and she very generously always says, up till now, to have rowed, and I'm going to emphasize that word, rowed, not sailed, not motorboated, but rowed across three oceans of this world, the Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, and the Indian Ocean, alone, without a supporting crew, very often with a satellite phone broken, but all of that is what we're going to hear about. And so, ladies and gentlemen, to hear about this spectacular journey of pivoting from the ordinary to the extraordinary, please welcome Roz Savage.
Such a pleasure to be here tonight. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Roz. We literally grabbed you. You know, she's here visiting in India, and we said, we have this club, we must present you. And Roz very sportingly agreed. So that's been a very, very fruitful day today.
I was very happy to be grabbed.
Okay. So Roz, I mean, as I just very briefly shared, this spectacular journey you've made from being, you know, a citizen of the commuter train to being a citizen of this little 23-foot boat on the ocean. You know, I shared about the obituary, but can you tell us about what really triggered you to move your life this drastically from where it was to where it is now?
Well, I suppose the reason that I was doing that obituary exercise was because I'd realized that that lifestyle wasn't really working for me. I don't know if it's because my parents were both Methodist preachers, but maybe there was something in my upbringing that having a vocation, like having some service to a greater purpose, is what you really want to do. And of course, I rebelled against that as a teenager. When I was 16, my dad did a work exchange to San Diego in California, and I saw this amazing lifestyle there. You can imagine in 1984, going from Britain to this amazing lifestyle in California, I wanted to have the big house and, you know, the swimming pool and all of that stuff. And so, yes, that led me through an Oxford law degree and into management consulting. And I thought I was a success. And I guess so did my parents, little suspecting what surprise I was about to spring on them. So I suppose what convinced me that there was something wrong with this picture was that everything that I had thought was going to bring me happiness just wasn't working. I know this. Achieved that.
Yes. So in fact, Roz, before we dive into the ocean with you, we wanted to share with the audience a little bit of the experience of being out in an open ocean, you know, and so I'm going to ask the console to just play that little video clip.
This is the trouble with oceans. There seems to be always not enough of something, or too much of it.
Absolute dead calm. And this is choppy compared with what it was like first thing. The wind is pushing me south. There's been pushed north. See now south of Antigua, more south. I'm weary and I've been out here for too long and I can't get on the phone to have a whinge to anybody else. Very, very hard going. Oh my God, but it's going to be hard. A strong urge just to curl up in my bunk. Tired, pissed off, sore. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough to take.
Roz, clearly the Methodists create a masochistic desire in one. You have to blame religion for this.
I never know quite how to feel about that video, like embarrassed that I just whinged so much to the camera or proud that I was that unhappy and I still managed to hang on in there. I should say why I chose to do this rather, yes, on the face of it, masochistic thing. During that transition, like after the obituary exercise, some very big changes happened in my life. I wish that I could say that I was courageous enough to make them all consciously, but I think that when I did that exercise, that fantasy obituary that I'd created, it was like a vision of how I wanted my life to turn out. And I wasn't actually courageous enough to actively pursue it, but I think subconsciously, kind of in my heart really, I knew that was the life that I was meant to be living. And so I ended up quitting my job and leaving a stable relationship and a number of other things that normally represent security, I chose to let go of. And I'm sure I caused my poor, long-suffering mother many sleepless nights at that stage. But to me, it was incredibly liberating. I felt like I was really starting to understand who I was and what I wanted to do in this lifetime. And it was around then that I had an environmental awakening. I took a trip to Peru and saw the retreating glaciers on the mountains in the Andes. And this was back in 2003. And I guess, well, certainly climate change hadn't really registered in my life in a big way. So when I got back to England, I did a load of research and I was like, oh my word, this is terrible. This is the most important issue and I absolutely have to do something about it. So I was really trying to find a way that I could get people's attention so that I could talk about the way that we need to treat nature with more respect if we expect the same in return. And that was really the biggest motivation for me taking off across the oceans. It wasn't pure masochism. I am not that masochistic, but I am a woman with a mission.
Masochism along with altruism, it's a deadly cocktail, you know? But Roz, I again wanted to share with the audience, just to give them a sense of the scale and spectacle of what you have managed. Would you share just some of the statistics, you know, of what you pulled off, you know, how many miles, how much of rowing, just how many days on the ocean. Would you quickly share that and then we'll get into the deeper experience of it?
So I suppose the headline stats are, yes, three oceans, 15,000 miles, about 5 million oar strokes, and a total of about 520 days at sea. That was over the course of 7 years. I was spending on average like 3 months of the year alone on the ocean. And just to emphasize, there was no support boat. I was there completely alone and self-sufficient and often very scared.
So I'm going to come to really the psychoscape you need, the psychology you need, the courage you need to pull this off. But still, to just stay with the surface a little bit, what was different about the three oceans? You know, for us, the ocean just looks an ocean and all of it looks scary. But was there a difference in personality and character between the Indian Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, and the Atlantic?
There may well be, but of course I've only crossed each one of them once, thank heavens. And so I only saw a very slender ribbon across each ocean. The Atlantic was always going to be the hardest because it was my first one. And I had an awful lot to learn about oceans and also about myself. I was on a very, very steep learning curve. And I also chose the worst possible year to do the Atlantic. It was 2005 when it was the year of Hurricane Katrina, Wilma, Rita. There were 28 named storms that year in the Atlantic. The next worst year, there were 20 named storms. So I wasn't in the eye of any of the hurricanes, but it was just generally extremely rough, which is why so much of the equipment broke. It was just completely unprecedented conditions. And as you saw in the video, I didn't handle it very well. Yes, everything was sort of going wrong around me, but it really took... It took me a lot of self-reflection to figure out how to cope with it better in here, because you know we always have a choice how to respond to what's happening around us. And practically everything I've ever learned in my life, I learned a lot by doing it the wrong way first, by getting completely overwhelmed and whinging a lot, not just to the camera, but also inside my own head, until I found more positive ways to reframe the situation, to keep myself going, and to stop myself going completely insane on the way across.
So what were those distillations, Roz, when you say that you reframe the situation? How do you reframe being alone on the Atlantic without a satellite phone for 23 days?
So here's an example, and there are many, but this is a good one that I hope might resonate with quite a lot of people in the audience. When we reach that stage where we've got a very ambitious undertaking and we're thinking, why the heck did this ever seem like a good idea? So there's one day that I'm rowing along and I've got the tendonitis in my shoulders and the saltwater sores on my bottom and my sleeping bag is damp and moldy and oars are broken and out of balance because I've had to patch them up. And my inner dialogue is very, very negative. I'm just like, oh, this is so uncomfortable. It's horrible. It's uncomfortable. And then I went, oh, hold on a moment. People kept asking me, why was I doing this thing? And apart from the environmental mission, I was also saying, maybe rather naively, I want to get outside my comfort zone. Well, of course, getting outside your comfort zone is going to be uncomfortable. I was like, oh, I guess I should be more careful what I wish for. And just that I flipped it around because I'd seen the discomfort as being a sign of failure. I didn't want to be another one of those whinging adventurers that complains about how miserable it is to be doing the thing that they chose to do. And yet here I was doing the exact same thing. So just flipping it around like that, going, actually, the discomfort is a sign that I'm succeeding. I am really seriously learning here. This is a majorly character-building experience because I am so far outside my comfort zone, it's not even funny. So it's funny how when we can't change our situation, we can completely flip our attitude towards it.
And so, Roz, before we move to the Pacific Ocean and the troubles kept escalating in a way, that 23 days, you know, I mean, yes, you were alone the entire rowing across the Atlantic, you lost your oars, you lost your camping stove, you ate a lot of granola bars, all of that. But when you're even cut off from your phone and you can't speak to anybody, what did that silence and that expanse do to you? You know, quite apart from reframing or anything intellectual you were doing, what did that do to you? Just that extreme isolation and hardship.
I'd be sort of curious, and I can't really see anybody very well because I'm a bit blinded by the lights, but I'd be curious to know how many people in the audience would absolutely love to be without their phone for 23 days. Yeah, okay, I can definitely see some hands go up.
You have three kindred souls here.
It felt, you know, it should have been disastrous, but actually it felt, I'm trying to think of a good word for it. I'm going to have to settle for amazing right now, but I'll come up with something better. The reason being that up until that point, when I had the satellite phone working, I was receiving weather information every day. And if the weather forecast was good, I'd get really excited. I would think, brilliant, I'm going to make really good mileage today. And if the weather forecast was bad, I'd be really worried about the upcoming storm. And the weather forecasts were mostly wrong anyway. But meanwhile, I've been on this emotional roller coaster, like of hope or despair. And so when the phone broke, it was just, I became so much more present in the moment. I wasn't always thinking about tomorrow and what might go well or what might go badly. It was just me and my little boat and this very big ocean. And my mindset completely changed. I think when I set out across the Atlantic, I'd been going through a very deeply spiritual stage of my life. And because I'd felt so called to go on this environmental mission, I'd fondly imagined that Mother Nature was going to go, here you go, Roz, have a lovely smooth trip across the Atlantic. It's all going to be lovely. You can meditate your way across. And of course, as you saw in the video, the reality was very, very different. I think the closest that I came to that kind of serenity was when the phone broke and suddenly it was just me now. It was that much simpler. Didn't have to deal with anybody else. Even just spending a few minutes on the phone each day to dry land had been a very strong umbilical cord. And when that cord was severed, it was like, okay, now here I am. I am taking full responsibility for what happens from now on. And it was, of course, my poor mum was like practically having kittens, wondering what the heck had happened to me. But very selfishly, from my point of view, it was one of the most liberating experiences of my life.
So, Roz, you know, you'd already been through this massive amount of discomfort, which you told yourself was a sign of success. But then you went back into the Pacific, you know. And I'll just quickly share with the audience, we might take a bit of time, that Roz, it took her weeks to break out of the Californian coast. The first time that she took off, your boat capsized like 4 times in 24 hours, and you had to abort the trip, you know. So again, can you talk about that experience when you already saw it was going to be that tumultuous? You'd already crossed one ocean. Why did you need to cross the second ocean, you know, and then by the third?
Well, I think in my mind, I'd already committed to doing the three. So if I'd have, there are a number of reasons. It would have felt like I was quitting if I hadn't have carried on and done the Pacific and the Indian Oceans. Also, I felt like I'd really not done a very good job of crossing the Atlantic, that I'd been, I'd made so many mistakes, and I put a lot of work after that experience into deliberately reliving it, talking about it, writing about it, really reflecting and drawing out the lessons that I'd learned that I could take forward into whatever I did next, not just rowing across oceans, but into like who I was as a person. And also, I mentioned the environmental mission. I felt like I'd spent so much of the Atlantic crossing just trying not to go crazy that I hadn't really done enough on the environmental side. So there was a lot of work still to do. Although having said that, I know that in between the Atlantic and the Pacific crossings, whenever I even thought about it, it was like this cold, icy hand just reached into my chest and grabbed hold of my heart and squeezed it. I was not looking forward to going out there again. And then, yes, as you say, there was... Shall we say, I got to meet some very charming gentlemen from the US Coast Guard, but I would have rather met them in a bar than in the middle of the Pacific. I didn't actually make the choice to ask for rescue, but I'd mentioned in my blog that the boat was capsizing and that I'd lost a couple of pieces of equipment and knocked my head a couple of times. But being of a somewhat stubborn nature, as you might have gathered, I was quite determined that I would have carried on, but somebody decided that he knew better than I did what was good for me, and so called out the Coast Guard to come and pick me up.
And is he still in your life?
No. He was absolutely on the periphery of my team, which I think just gave him the sense that he had enough authority to make this decision, even though my weatherman had told him to mind his own business.
Okay, so Okay.
Are we nearly out of time
yes,
already?
Yes, we're nearly out of time. So just the last thoughts,
I'm
Roz.
I'm having fun.
when you said that it completely transformed you and that, you know, you've been giving and you're doing a course on courage in Yale, or is it Harvard? So can you just
Yale.
Distill
yeah.
that lesson of courage that this entire voyage taught you?
Just before I distill it, I would like to mention briefly why I'm in Delhi, and I'm aware that we're running out of time, but I've been teaching a condensed version of the same course on courage to the Vedika scholars here in Delhi, which is a fantastic program for young women. And I know that they look to place all of their graduates in positions in corporate Delhi, and a really amazing organization, incredible young women. So I suppose if there's one thing that I would like to say about courage based on my experiences, courage is certainly not the absence of fear. In fact, it's an essential component of courage is fear. But when your motivation is greater than your fear, that's when you're able to move forward and do the thing that you know is the right thing with courage.
And you've also said that courage can be taught and unlearned. Is that true? Can you really teach courage?
You know what? I think that we all have courage. And if we haven't felt it yet, it just means that we haven't challenged ourselves enough yet. I had no idea how courageous I could be until I set out across my first ocean. And as time went on, my whole definition of myself, my self-concept changed. And so, rightly or wrongly, I now have much greater ambitions about what I can achieve. I still have an environmental mission. And now that I know that I'm doing really big and unpleasant projects that nobody else wants to take on, I'm very willing to, again, put that to service, not on the ocean this time, but what I'm working on at the moment is very much about accelerating the transition from fossil fuels to renewable energy. So that we can mitigate climate change. That's what I'm working on now.
So finally, Roz, we'll have to get off stage, but now, finally, what is your obituary going to say about Roz Savage?
Well, I hope... So my dad used to say, whatever you do, put your whole heart into it. And I hope that whatever I have done and whatever I continue to do, that I always put my whole heart into it.
Okay. Thank you, Roz. Do we have time for questions, or we're running out of time? No, okay. I'm sorry, we've run out of time because, as we said, this was not a scheduled session. So some of you have sent questions, but Roz is going to be here, so we're going to have a cocktail break. Do ask her in person, and forgive me for not calling out the questions. Thank you so much for sharing this with us, Roz. I wish we had more time to talk to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.